The Boys, written by Garth Ennis, art by Darick Robertson. It is a comic series that initially was on DC's Wildstorm imprint back in 2006, but that imprint went away, and luckily Garth Ennis was able to move that comic series over to Dynamite Comics and finish the entire run, ending in 2012. So The Boys has, I believe, 72 issues, as well as some connecting miniseries. It's collected right now in like 12 trade paperbacks, as well as various omnibuses, so you can buy the whole thing right now. And the series is going to be a TV show on Amazon Prime coming out on July 26th, and I am really excited for the TV show, and I'm really excited to talk to you all about what this series is and break down Volume 1 in this video. So I'm going to be covering issues 1 through 6 and explaining the story so you can get into it before the TV show comes out. So what is The Boys? So The Boys is about a CIA-backed team of dangerous people, and they are there to rein in the world's superpowered superhero people and potentially take them down if necessary. Most of the superheroes in this story are actually kind of egotistical jerks who are sort of like celebrities and sort of just enjoying their high status in the world. And Garth Ennis takes a very sort of cynical look at superpowered people. So it's a very interesting take, very fun, very dark, twisted book. There's lots of sexual stuff, some nudity, there's violence and gore and swearing, and all sorts of good stuff. It's definitely for mature readers. Now, Garth Ennis is one of my favorite writers. I highly recommend his Vertigo series, Preacher. That is the book he is best known for. It was also made into a TV show on AMC, and it's a really good TV show as well. I also highly liked his Punisher run at Marvel. It was like 9 years, one of the best Punisher runs ever. Really good stuff. So if you like that stuff, if you like Garth Ennis, you're definitely going to like The Boys because it is such a good time. Okay, let's dive into the story in the first volume, looking at issues 1 through 6, and get to know these characters. So when the book opens up, the name of the first story arc is called The Name of the Game. And in the first issue, we are introduced to this character, The Butcher. He is a member of this The Boys team, and he has a pet dog named Terror. Then we are introduced to this woman named Susan Rayner, and she is the director of the CIA. And she meets up with this The Butcher character, and they have like this dirty hate sex. And then afterwards, The Butcher is talking with that CIA director lady, and he learns of a presidential directive charging the CIA with monitoring all superheroes. And The Butcher uses this directive to get the backing required to reform his team, The Boys, a black ops team designed to police the superhero community. He's gonna put together this CIA-backed team of dangerous people, each one dedicated to the struggle against superheroes when they need to be reined in, maybe even killed if they go rogue. Then we are introduced to this guy, Wee Hughie Campbell, and he was drawn to look like actor Simon Pegg. In fact, if you read the first volume of The Boys, even an introduction from Simon Pegg talking about that whole situation going down, and the artist Darick Robertson saying that, you know, does he have the permission to draw this guy to look like Simon Pegg? And Simon Pegg was all for it. So when you read this series, you're definitely going to be seeing him in your mind. So this guy, Hughie Campbell, he loves his girlfriend, and they are enjoying the day, and they are out and about in this park, and all of a sudden, she accidentally gets killed by this superhero villain fight going on, and there's this guy named A-Train, and as he's running through, he says, "Out of my fucking way!" And he's running so fast, he accidentally runs through this guy's girlfriend, and she explodes in a bloody, gory mess, and she's dead. So basically, this A-Train is sort of like The Flash. So imagine if The Flash ran so fast he accidentally killed pedestrians, something that could definitely happen. So back at this fight scene, in the aftermath of it, this Wee Hughie Campbell is crying over the loss of his girlfriend. Meanwhile, this A-Train, this Flash-type superhero, he could really kind of care less. He's talking to the cops about this, you know, collateral damage he just caused, but, you know, he doesn't really care that much. Later on in the issue, some lawyers show up at Wee Hughie's house, and they're trying to talk him into not pursuing legal action against A-Train. Hughie sort of refuses, and he just wants his girlfriend back, and he's crying, and he's a mess. And then we jump back over to that butcher guy. The butcher then goes to see this CIA analyst he knows named Kessler, and he uses that analyst to get some information, and he wants to learn more about this Hughie guy's situation, the guy who lost his girlfriend, and he's going to try to recruit him into his group. Jumping over to issue two now, part two of the name of the game storyline. So we are introduced to the rest of the boys, the rest of the team. There's the Frenchman, and he displays a tendency for extreme violence. Within the first few frames of his appearance, he's already like attacking people. He's in this little cafe, he likes his espresso, but he's also crazy. When some of the people make fun of his French accent, he headbutts and takes all these people down. We're introduced to the female of the species, that's her name. She is known for her brutality, which visibly even shocks the butcher. She is seen ripping someone's face off in this opening scene. And she also has selective mutism, so she's often very quiet, often not speaking. We're also introduced to Mother's Milk, a large African-American man. He's highly patient and methodical. He was taught by his father to check for every possible angle and means of attack, and he can be somewhat particular. In this opening scene, he is complaining that the butcher is not putting a drink coaster under his glasses, and his nickname, Mother's Milk, apparently came about because he is the purest, the most good-hearted member of the boys. So, Mother's Milk, what can be more pure than that? Throughout this issue, the butcher is talking to Hughie and trying to recruit him. At first, they bond over their hatred of this Shih Tzu in the park, and the butcher gets his dog Terror to have sex with this Shih Tzu on command as sort of a way to mess with it. And, you know, he just says to his dog, fuck it, and then the dog starts having sex with it. So sort of that absurdist humor that Garth Ennis is known for we see here. So the butcher explains to Hughie that he's putting together this team, and he doesn't like the way Hughie was treated. And if Hughie wanted revenge, he could join up with his CIA-backed team and take down the superpower people that deserve it, like this A-Train who accidentally killed Hughie's girlfriend. And the butcher says it will only happen again unless these superpower people are kept in check. Now, we also learn from this interaction that Hughie is someone that is very into conspiracy theories. When he finds out the butcher is working for the CIA, he starts going on a little rant about, you know, all of these theories he has about the government. So Huey's not fully on board, but the butcher gives Hughie a few $1,000 and tells him to come to New York and check this whole situation out and get himself settled in. And that is sort of how issue two ends, end of the first story arc, sort of setting up the team. Now, issue three is called Cherry, and it's a four-issue arc. And here we're sort of getting into a little bit more of the various characters. So we are introduced to this character, Annie January, and she is an evangelical Christian who fights crime as the superheroine Starlight back in Des Moines, Iowa, with this group called the Young Americans. So we're introduced to more of these other superhero teams in the world, and she is recruited to join this group called the Seven. They are the most elite of the superhero teams in this world. So think of the Justice League or the Avengers. That is what the Seven is. They are, you know, this big superhero team, and she is really excited to get called up to the big leagues and join the Seven. But she quickly learns that the Seven are not as wholesome as their reputation suggests, as she is coerced to perform oral sex on this superhero called the Homelander to gain entry into this group. The Homelander is kind of a very patriotic superhero, sort of like Captain America in a way. But you know, he's trying to get this girl to blow him, so he's obviously not the nicest guy, right? Now, Annie at first refuses to give a blowjob, And then she meets the other members of the Seven. So there's this guy, Black Noir, and he is always seen in silhouette with his face obscured. As well as we see A-Train, that Flash-type hero who accidentally killed that person in issue one. And, you know, she sees them and she thinks that they're going to protect him, but they also pull down their pants and are waiting for their blowjobs as well. So, you know, they're kind of like sexually harassing this girl immediately. So Andy says to these three guys, "You're Earth's most mighty. You bring justice to all. You avenge the innocent. You're the Seven. You know, like, how could you do this?" And the Homelander responds, "Yeah. And we like to get our dick sucked." And then A-Train cuts in. "Can't stop the A-Train," as they're all, you know, have no pants on and are, you know, getting closer to her. So she tells them all to go to hell. But the Homelander says, "Well, in that case, then, good luck back in the Corn Belt with your loser hero group." And, you know, Annie eventually... you know, sort of gives it some thought, and she, you know, she wants to be in the A-League. She doesn't want to go back to her small-time team. So she eventually does it. She blows them all. And then afterwards, we see her puking in the bathroom. So not a very happy start to this team. So Annie, she meets this other hero, part of the Seven, named Queen Maeve. And Queen Maeve is called Empress of the Otherworld. And Annie really respected this Queen Maeve, and she's a really big fan of her. And as she's giving Queen Maeve some compliments, Queen Maeve really wants nothing to do with this. She seems really bitchy and indifferent to Annie. Now, jumping over to Hughie now. So Hughie shows up in New York. He finds a shitty apartment, and then he is off with the Butcher to meet the rest of the group. Now, the rest of the boys are pretty accepting of Hughie initially, and, you know, they're all sort of bonding a bit. And the boys' first mission is a teenage superhero group called Teenage Kicks. Teenage Kicks are a more edgy Gen X version of, like, a superhero team, of, like, a Young Justice-type team. They're, like, on the wrong side of the tracks. They have tattoos and piercings. And apparently heroes like A-Train started out in Teenage Kicks. So the boys think that, you know, let's start out small. Let's sort of deal with this teenage team and then maybe move onwards. Issue 4 now, Cherry Part 2, is we see the boys and they are spying on Teenage Kicks. And Teenage Kicks is into some downright nasty stuff. We see they're having orgies in their headquarters with these prostitutes and all sorts of shenanigans. Jumping over to the Seven, they are having their first team meeting. We are meeting more members of the Seven. So there is the Deep. He is a water-based hero and he's wearing some sort of scuba gear. He's sort of like an analog to Aquaman. And there is a really funny scene with all of the members of the Seven, and they are arguing about merchandise rights. And the Deep is asking, you know, why does Homelander, Black Noir, and Queen Maeve get 1% of all merchandising, where the rest of the team only gets 0.75%? And they continue arguing about it, talking about their lawyers and the points calculated and how Homeland, Black Noir, and Queen Maeve are part of the original Trinity, so they should get more. And, you know, like, really funny. This is a really funny scene. You know, it's like, I love the bureaucraticness if the Justice League argued about, you know, their toys and the money off of it. So really funny stuff. Now, while Annie is giving her welcoming speech, A-Train is miming a blowjob motion, sort of like making fun of her. Now, after the meeting, though, Homelander is pissed at A-Train, and he yells at him for pulling that stunt in the meeting, because during their sort of team meeting, they were in front of a group called Vought American. And Vought American is sort of like the money people who sort of like fund the Seven. And Homelander is telling A-Train, you can't be acting childish in front of them. And he threatens to sort of laser A-Train with his eyes and kick him off the team if he doesn't smarten up. You know, never act foolish in front of the money people. So meanwhile, Teenage Kicks is being monitored by the boys and they are collecting all sorts of blackmail on them. Butcher is talking to Hughie and injects Hughie with some kind of compound called Compound V. And it is revealed that all superpowers come from Compound V. It was a drug invented by Nazi scientists, and when sort of given to people, they develop superpowers. And the Butcher tells Hughie that, you know, if you're gonna be on our team, we can't have you, you know, being punched in the face or something and dying immediately. So you need sort of a little bit of these superpowers to sort of be able to last. So Hughie asks if there's any side effects, and the Butcher says, well, it's gonna turn your shit blue, but other than that, you'll be fine. Now, we also learn that there's also a lower powered version that is sort of mixed with cocaine, and it can be given to people and they'll get like a powerful high and will get superpowers temporarily. And apparently, you know, that's sort of what was going on with these various prostitutes in this Teenage Kicks. The prostitutes didn't have a little bit of this Compound V, and they probably wouldn't be able to survive sex with Teenage Kicks, but because they had some, they were able to survive. Anyway, that's a little bit about how the world works in this comic. Jumping over to issue 5 now, Cherry Part 3. Hughie's on a park bench. He's deciding if he's going to stay with the boys and part of this new group. He meets Annie from the Seven, who, you know, is not having the best sort of time with her new superhero group there. And they are getting to talking. Both are doubting their new positions. Neither knows who the other is. They're sort of just talking as strangers. But they bond a bit and they talk a little bit more. And they will perhaps meet again in the future. Is that where they leave things off? Hughie decides to rejoin the boys, and him and the Butcher sort of make up. And, you know, after this whole Butcher drugging him with this Compound V and giving him powers, so they're able to sort of move past this. Meanwhile, Teenage Kicks has gotten a note from the boys, and all the blackmail that the boys have collected on Teenage Kicks of all their various orgies and whatnot. And Teenage Kicks is told that they have to sacrifice a team member to the media and sort of reveal themselves and some of the bad things that they have been up to, or the boys will decide for them. Teenage Kicks ends up choosing to out one of their black closeted gay superheroes as gay and push him out of the closet in a way. And he ends up coming out to the world and vows to leave the team because of it. So after this sort of announcement from Teenage Kicks, the Seven, who are, you know, the big superheroes in this world, they hear the announcement and they worry that it is the work of the Butcher and the boys, and it is like a warning shot to them. So, you know, that's sort of a tease of what's to come in the future. Also, we get another creepy scene of the Homelander, and he tells Annie, or Starlight as her superhero name is, that you know, she needs to make her costume a little bit more sexual, and he draws on her shirt telling her where to make the edits to make a more revealing costume. So kind of funny there. And then this issue ends with Teenage Kicks confronting the boys on the street to a fight, because Teenage Kicks has figured out that it was the boys that sort of set them up, and they're ready to throw down with them. Issue 6 now, Cherry Part 4. The fight starts with the boys and Teenage Kicks. And the boys are handling it well enough. The Butcher is not scared at all. Hughie is scared though. He's the newest member of the group. He doesn't fully understand the extent of his new powers. And he punches right through this one hero named Blarney Cock and kills him. So in the heat of this battle, wee Hughie Campbell accidentally kills someone. No one's too angry at Hughie though. They realize he didn't know what he was doing, but you know, the Butcher didn't want to kill anyone. That's not why they were here. And then the Butcher says, ugh, now this Teenage Kicks, the people are gonna have one of their fucking funerals that these superheroes always have. So it's not exactly, you know, the best first mission here. Funeral happens, all the other Teenage Kicks members give their condolences and make a whole production of it. Hughie is considering leaving, but you know, because after he killed someone, it sort of shocks his system, but he is talked into staying. And then the Butcher shares a story of why he does this job. Apparently, the Butcher's wife got raped by the Homelander back in the day, and the baby in her belly eventually busted out of her stomach. And because the baby was like so superpowered, you know, the wife died and the butcher had to beat the kid to death, who was like firing lasers out of his eyes. And, you know, the butcher eventually found his wife's diary and figured all this out. So the butcher's sort of vow in life is to take the Homelander down. And that is, you know, his motivation for forming this group and why he wants to do what he is doing. He also explains that the superpowered people are dangerous. They potentially cannot be stopped. So the government is nervous about them, which is, you know, why the need for his group is here. The issue ends with the Seven. They're giving a press conference and we see their new member Starlight in her new revealing costume, and the Homelander is sort of giving a speech here, and we see the boys are watching this on TV. Mother's Milk says to the Butcher, you know, maybe some of them have their hearts in the right place. Like, there might be one or two good soups out there, good superpowered people out there. And then the Butcher replies, well, if there are, fuck them. And then that's how it ends, with the boys sort of ready to sort of continue on their mission of taking down these various superpowered people. And that is the end of Volume 1. So yeah, that was The Boys Volume 1, a very twisted book indeed. Sometimes a little bit too twisted for my liking, but still, I have a lot of fun with this series. It's a good time. I like exploring the idea of what if the Justice League were kind of jerks, you know? They're there to save people, sure, and save the world, but really, they are in it for the money and the corporate glory that comes with being a superhero. And, you know, how do you take these superpowered people down, you know? It's a compelling premise. It's a good book. It's a fun time. I'm excited for the show. I'm going to give this opening volume an 8.5 out of 10, and I highly recommend checking it out, especially if you're a fan of Garth Ennis's past work.